Thank you. I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. And so what I would like to discuss today is actually a little more general theorem than what was in the abstract. So it's joint work with Cyril Lecuyer. So it seems that we are able to prove the full quasi-isometric rigidity of the class of Kleinian groups now. So let G be a finitely generated group quasi-isometric to a Kleinian group. Then G contains a finite index subgroup isomorphic to a Kleinian group. So what I would like to try to do is to give the main ingredients for the proof of this result and tell you the difference when it's, the group is convex co-compact. And so the strategy is exactly the same, but each time we work with a general case, it's more difficult, almost at each step. So I would like to explain what where it comes from and why it was not proved to start with. Okay, so let me first remind you that what I mean by a Kleinian group, it's a discrete subgroup K of PSL to C. Okay, and you can see it first as acting on hyperbolic three space by isometries. So the action is properly discontinuous. And it also acts on the Riemann sphere by Möbius transformations. So the action usually is not properly discontinuous on the sphere, but there is a natural partition of the Riemann sphere into the limit set and the omega, and so the limit set where the dynamics is chaotic, and omega, which is the ordinary set, where the action is properly discontinuous. And so these two actions actually can be seen simultaneously if we, for instance, we see H3 as the three ball in R3 and the sphere as its boundary. In this case, we get an action. And the limit set is the accumulation point of any point, any orbit at infinity. And so there's that. Drawing something like that. So usually the limit set is a fractal. And so you pick any point and it will accumulate in any place. Okay, so this is it. Okay, so one point of interest for Kleinian groups is its tight relationship with three manifolds. So here I will assume all the time, because I'm just interested in what's going on up to quasi-isometry and up to finite index, that the groups are torsion-free. So if K is torsion-free, then you can define the Kleinian manifold. M sub K, it will be So I look at the action on the hyperbolic 3 space and in the ordinary set. So since the action is properly discontinuous, I can take its quotient and it gives me a manifold. So it's a 3 manifold which is orientable and has a complete hyperbolic structure in the interior. Okay, so the group K is convex co-compact. If the manifold is itself compact. Another way of seeing that is to consider the convex hull of the limit set in H3. And so because the limit set is totally invariant by the action of the group, the convex hull too, and to be convex so compact, it will be equivalent to saying that the action is co-compact on the convex hull. And so this is an equivalent definition for convex co-compactness. So the problem with the general thing is, first here, we have almost, the only thing that we know on the Kleinian group is that it is finitely generated. We have no structure somehow on the thing. So, but we have a lot of freedom because we can try to deform it by isomorphism. So and through the right group we want to look at to use the geometry of the Kleinian group to find a subgroup which is isomorphic to it. It follows from, so the first step is to choose a good K in its isomorphism class. Okay, so it turns out from Thurston's theory that we can always assume that K is geometrically finite. And all parabolic points and all points are rank 2, have rank 2. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that the Kleinian manifold here has a compact piece, and you have finitely many ends, which are all so the structure is you have a compact piece, and finitely many tori, which goes to infinity. Okay, so, and of course, when the group is already convex co-compact, then it's already a good model. So we can use the geometry of the convex compactness. Okay, so here, what does it mean for K? So in particular, it means that if you pick a collection of representative of the conjugacy classes of the parabolic stabilizers, then this is a relatively hyperbolic group. With all P in PK, which is isomorphic to Z square. So the thing will be to work with this setting. So what are the first consequences that we get from that? Is that the group G itself will be relatively hyperbolic. And also because the z-squares are not relatively hyperbolic groups themselves, we know that we have a good structure. So first, so the consequences from the assumptions. Maybe the first that I should have said is that the group G is finitely presented. Because it is quasi-isometric to a finitely presented group. And second, G is relatively hyperbolic and with peripheral subgroups which are virtually And so in the convex to compact case, we know that the group is directly word hyperbolic, okay, which is much stronger and provides much more information. So from this kind of things, what we know is that there's a canonical boundary that we can define for a relatively hyperbolic group, which is called the Bowditch boundary, which consists in gluing. So you have your Kelle graph. I don't know how to draw a Kelle graph. So, so you have a Kelle graph, and what you do is you glue. You can manage to get an action. An action by isometries. On a proper hyperbolic space in the sense of Gromov. So that each peripheral subgroup is the stabilizer of a point. And all the other stabilizers, which are not conjugate to one of these, are finite. I mean, cyclic or finite, elementary. Okay, so it's exactly what's happening for the Clennen group K. That here we have the action, we have some cusps, and each time you have the cusp, the stabilizer is exactly the square. And so, the boundary at infinity of this space, so maybe I should give it a name, space X, is what is called a Bowditch boundary. And so what we obtain here is an action. Yes? P, the little p? Yes, yes. I'm sorry, I did it backwards. Sorry. So the action that you obtain on the boundary is an action which is called a uniformly quasi-Möbius. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that we have a natural family of metrics which are so-called visual metrics, and the group does not distort cross ratios. We have a bound on them. So there exists a distortion function, which is a homeomorphism, such that each time you pick a cross ratio, 4 points and an element of the group, then you look at the cross ratio of the image, is controlled by the cross ratio. So here, what is the cross ratio? It's a metric cross ratio. So here, so you can have several normalizations, but they are all equivalent. Okay, so I'm used to using that one. But what is important is that you use the 4 letters each time. You make the product of the distances and divide them by another way. Okay. In particular, what is interesting is that when the cross ratio is small here, it is small there also. And this is enough to characterize Möbius transformations. And so in our setting, what we obtain is that the limit set of my Clennian group is also the Bowditch boundary of the group, okay, with the same geometry. And so we obtain directly an action by uniformly quasi-Möbius action on the subset of the Riemann sphere. fact that G is quasi-isometric to K implies that G acts on the limit set. And the action is a conjugate to the action that I had here on the boundary dx. And so now there's a famous theorem of Sullivan, which says that if a group that a group of uniform quasi-Möbius maps on the Riemann sphere is conjugate to a group of Möbius mappings. Okay. And so then if the limit set is the whole sphere, then we're already done. Okay, and so this is corollary, which is due, I guess, to Cannon Cooper. Maybe I should quote Schwartz. If lambda k is a whole Riemann sphere, then it's not really G, it's the action of G, which is conjugate. To that of the Kleinian group. So what I claimed in my theorem, it was something a little stronger, meaning that G contained a finite index subgroup, which was itself Kleinian, not a quotient. Okay, so I'll come back to that later on. I don't want to mix everything, but there is a genuine difficulty actually to prove that. I don't have any simple proof of going from finite quotient to subgroup. So one strategy could, for the general case, would be, well, I have this action which is already nice on the limit set, and I could try to extend it to the Riemann sphere to keep it uniformly quasi-Möbius and then apply this theorem. But you have to realize that it's, in general, it's hopeless to proceed like that because the topology of the limit set can be very complicated. For instance, if it is not connected, there's no reason why you should be able to extend even one element to a global homeomorphism. And even when it is connected, there are many difficulties because you have local cut points and you can change the way the action acts has nothing to do with the action of G on the limit set of K has nothing to do with the action of K on its limit set, a priori. So we need to add some more structure and work differently. Maybe before explaining how I want to proceed, what I should do is provide other cases where the theorem was known for a long time, which will enable me to rule out these cases in the sequel. So for instance, you know that the theorem is known for other known cases. So when K is free, due to Starlings, I guess. When K is a function this is due to Casson-Jung-Rice and Gabay, and some many cases were treated by Tukia before. And so in this case, the limit set, of course, is I think that it's homeomorphic to the circle. So I want to go to other cases. So since it's complicated to look at the whole action of the group because we have all these cut points and stuff like that and all the components, the first idea is to try to cut the manifold, the group into pieces, and then study each piece and show that they are themselves closer to Kleinian groups. And from that, we'll get some more structure to work with. So. So the first step will be to split G into pieces. Okay. Then for each piece, so that each piece is virtually Kleinian. And then once we have these pieces, we can try to, we can associate the three manifolds, get a collection of manifolds MV, the Kleinian manifolds, that we want to piece together back. And obtain manifold M such that the fundamental group hopefully will be isometric, will be isomorphic to G. And then we can apply Thurston's theorem. So this is how we want to prove the theorem. In both cases, convex co-compact or general case, or geometrically finite. Okay, so the splitting of the pieces, I will use the splitting of elementary groups. So these are very well understood when the group is word hyperbolic. When it's not the case, we have to use more powerful results for finitely presented groups, and it becomes much more delicate. Okay, so this is the first instance where there's a big difference, I think. And then to show that each piece is virtually Kleinian, it won't be that hard once it will be more or less the same pattern as for both cases. And then we have a problem here because there's no reason why these manifolds we will be able to glue them together to get a three manifold with exactly the right fundamental group. Because here, the only thing we can get is to get something up to finite index. And so it's not the way that we want to glue them back along annuli and stuff like that might not give us a manifold at all. So here there's a lot of work. In the case of word hyperbolic groups, it was well explained by the work of Wise on cat zero cube complexes. In our setting, when the groups are only relatively hyperbolic, he doesn't cover exactly the cases we need. Okay? So we had to play a little bit with that to be able to get something of finite index there. And then Thurston's theorem is Thurston's theorem is the same. It doesn't make much difference in the case. So let me try to detail a little bit all these steps and say what are the main things. So the first thing we can do is, since G is finitely presented, it is accessible, so we can split it over finite groups. Over finite groups. we obtain a first action on H3, T1. Simply short action with no edge inversions. Finite quotient such that the stabilizers of edges are all finite and the stabilizers of vertices are either finite or one-ended subgroups. Okay, so in our setting, it corresponds to look at the stabilizers of the connected components for the one-ended subgroups. So the one-ended subgroups correspond exactly to the non-trivial connected components of lambda k. And so, now this group G is quasi-isometric to K. I want to relate the action of the vertices to the action of the same splitting that I can do with K when I cut along compression disks, my manifold. Okay, so this is a result of Papazoglou and White. Which says that the quasi-isometry between G and K gives us quasi-isometries between the one-ended. Okay, so in some sense, I have reduced the general case to the case where I can assume that at least lambda k is connected right now. But this is still not enough to try to use Sullivan's theorem. And so when the group is hyperbolic, it's not very hard to check that this is true. But here, because the structure is not really on the, I don't know how to say it. But the geometry coming from the relative hyperbolicity is much weaker in some sense. Because it's not exactly on the Kelly graph, it's on a graph that you have transformed to get the hyperbolicity. And if it's easy to go from the Kelly graph to the new space X that I have talked about earlier, it's very hard to go back, actually. Okay, so now that we split over finitely many finite groups, I want to split over two-ended subgroups, so apply a JSJ deformation. So the version that I'm using, so in the case of word hyperbolic groups, is due to Bowditch. And it was adapted to relatively hyperbolic groups by Groff. So the idea is that we can read splittings over two-ended groups from the topology of the limit set of K. And so what we obtain for G, for instance, is that we get a new action. So now I assume that G is one-ended, and so K also, and that lambda K is not homomorphic to the circle. So we get an action on the second tree with no edge inversions. Implicial, of course. And so what do we have is that the edge groups are all two-ended. And the limit sets disconnect the whole boundary, so lambda k. And for the vertices, we have at least four types of them. So the first time, GV, it's also two-ended. And as here, it disconnects also the limit set. Or it could be a so-called surface group. So this means that GV is virtually free, and its limit set has a canonical cyclic order. Then there is a third type, which is called rigid, meaning that a priori, we don't exactly understand what's going on. Okay. So it's relatively quasi-convex and not one of the above cases. And the third case is GV is one of these parabolic subgroups or conjugate to it. And this corresponds to cut points on lambda k. Okay. So in the case of convex co-compact groups, we don't have any cut points. Okay, so this latter thing does not appear. And also what we know from Bowditch is that the graph is always finite, the quotient. Whereas in general, we can say nothing about it. Also, it's not even clear that if you do the same, we have also an action of k on the same tree with the same properties. So in the case of word hyperbolic groups, it's not very hard to check that the vertex groups will all be quasi-isometric one to the other. In the general case, it's not, does not come for free. So here we have an action of k also. Exactly the same. And each time GV is two-ended, KV will be two-ended. Each time it is a surface, it will be a surface, and so forth. And so to understand first, for instance, if the quotient is finite in the case of G, in the case of K, it is well known because it comes from the geometry, but in the case of the group G, we had to go through the Bowditch's paper and check how he proved the finiteness of the graph. So it seems that for the surface groups and the rigid, for the two-ended and the surface groups, there were, he already proved the finiteness of the number of orbits of these things and of the edges which takes out. And we had to work to understand what was going on for these stabilizers of points. So one way, so we had to make a local study of the parabolic subgroups and prove that the action was exactly what the one that we thought, exactly as if it was a Kleinian group somehow, even if it's only virtually z squared and not z squared. Okay, so the thing is that if you send the point at infinity, what you get is a collection of components, an infinite collection of components which are permuted by the stabilizer K. So here I have two actions on this. So the point P, the point infinity is a parabolic point for both G and K. And here I'm looking at the action of the stabilizer inside K. Okay, so let H. Point at infinity. Inside K of the point at infinity. So which is isomorphic to Z squared. Okay? So we know exactly what is this action. So we have an action by translation by this, like that, and another one like this, right? Which permutes the colors. And so all these sort of lines, which 200 lines which go to infinity, they are well distributed. And what we know is that the action of the stabilizer of the point at infinity for the other group has to preserve this orbit, and it is also co-compact on the limit set. Okay. Take off the stabilizer inside G. It's compact. So from this, we can see that all the stabilizers are two-ended for each component, and they are all commensurable 2 by 2. For each component. Each component is virtually cyclic. And they are all and pairwise commensurable. So this means that the stabilizers inside G, it acts essentially exactly as the one from K. And this shows that we have only finitely many edges, orbit edges attached to a parabolic point, for instance. And so this is the step that one of the pieces which we're missing to prove that the graph will be finite, the quotient graph, to have only finitely many pieces to work with. And the fact also that, well, here I'm a little early, but that they are all, the components are all commensurable 2 by 2 is important when I will want to build a manifold, because I will have to create a torus and glue the torus to some to finitely many pieces, and I want them to be in the same homotopy class. Because these cut points come from accidental parabolics. Yes, they are, yes, because the stabilizers are, I don't know if they are abelian or not at this point. And, but the action is, you can change the metric on the limit set to make it by isometries, for instance. So, where am I? And so what I wanted to prove is that, okay, so the next thing is what I claim, or proposition, if you want. The quasi-isometry between K and G yields quasi-isometries in vertex groups. So it turns out that because the peripheral subgroups are all virtually abelian, the vertex groups are undistorted in the Kelly graph of G and that. So this is, I think it, I learned this from paper of Ruska on relative quasi-convex subgroups. Maybe it's from somebody else, I don't know. So think that the vertex groups are undistorted. And what we know also from the work of Papazoglou is that the image of a vertex group is bounded, is essentially the vertex group of the image. Inside G are mapped and the fact that they are undistorted and the image is exactly what we want tells us that we get a quasi-isometry, vertices by vertices. Okay, so what is even better is that it, because of the structure of the tree, it has to map also the edge groups to the edge groups. What we obtain is that for the non-elementary vertices, at least for the in the case of surface and rigid edge, we obtain quasi-isometries between the vertex and the collection of edge groups which are incident. Do the same here. Okay, so as relatively hyperbolic group, they will map the peripheral structure close to the peripheral structure there. And this is much better because now we have the quasi-isometry which was just on the groups, now they are decorated because we have these edge groups added to them. Okay? So in our quest for Kleinian groups, of course, when it's two-ended, we know how to that it is virtually a subgroup of PSL2C. You just take the finite index group, which is cyclic, and can realize it. It's the same for surface groups, because we have this canonical order, and then we can apply Tukey's theorem, for instance. For the case of abelian, so it's virtually abelian, so we also know how to realize it as a convex or compact group if we want. But not a convex or compact, I mean as a Kleinian group, like a Lattice and Z2. The essential problem is how to deal with the rigid cases. And so in this case, we have this quasi-isometry which preserves the edges. And so one way to understand how this is done is to pinch. So here, this is a genuine Kleinian group, so we have a manifold for, underlying this this group, and these curves, these subgroups, correspond to annuli and provides an asymmetrical pairing on, of the group of the manifold. So this data provides paired asymmetrical manifold. M sub G with the pair P. So what is quite standard then is to pinch the manifold to create cusps, to send all the edges at infinity. And because it is acylindrical, so what we'll get is there exists a new Kleinian group K prime V, which will be isomorphic. Okay, so V, where all the parabolic points all the edge roofs have become parabolic. All. Anyway. And because it is asymmetrical, I can assume that it has a totally geodesic boundary. Okay, so what does it mean on its limit set? Limit set, it is the complement of pairwise disjoint round disks and of measure zero. Has measure zero because it is a geometrically finite group. And the quasi-isometry that we obtain here, exactly as in the beginning, will give me an action of G sub V on lambda prime k by quasi-Möbius mappings. Action. By. On this. So from this, actually, there is some sort of miracle which happens. There's a theorem of Bonk, Kleiner, and Merenkov, which tells us exactly how does such mappings look like. In the particular case where you act on the complement of a collection of round disks of measure zero. There are always restrictions of Möbius mappings. So it means that the action of GV on this set is already an action by Möbius transformations. For any quasi-Möbius map. Self-map on lambda k prime v is the restriction of a Möbius mapping. So it means that these rigid pieces, they are also Kleinian groups. So they are not exactly the Kleinian groups I was expecting because I have created many parabolic points by making the pinching to start with. But then it's easy to kill all the rank one parabolic points that I've created using, again, Thurston's theorem. You have a manifold which is with rank one, you can modify it, kill them. So it's something that I already use implicitly in the first setting. So maybe something that I should have said is the fact that we obtain an action by quasi-Möbius maps here, that we get the same geometry, it follows also from the work of Groff that when he works on the JSJ decomposition, first thing that he does is he shows that when relatively hyperbolic groups are quasi-isometric, then the quasi-isometry remains a quasi-isometry when we add the whole balls to make them parabolic in the standard sense. So before I erase that, what I try to convince you is that each vertex group now is virtually a Kleinian group. Now what we have to do is to try to glue them back together and make sure that we'll get a manifold. Of course, since at each step we are taking finite index subgroups, we don't know how they look like. Okay? And so there's no reason why it should be the case. But so one thing that we have is the planarity of the limit set, which tells us at least that the boundary curves, for instance, they are simple, for instance, for each vertex group. But we don't know if they are primitive, and of course, it's very hard to see how to. There's no reason why it should be the case. So there are some cases. Where we know we can conclude is what I would like to call a regular JSG decomposition. For G. And so what does it mean? It means that, for instance, G is torsion-free, which is not bad to create a manifold. Okay, what I want also is that the edge groups here are all the same, for instance, at parabolic points. Edge groups. Are cyclic. Okay, and another condition is that there's a problem at the when also when you have pair of cut points, because you want them to be all in the same homotopy class when you want to glue them back to analyze. So you want that for any loxodromic edge group G sub E. Its action on the set of connected components of lambda k, take of this, is trivial. What I'm saying is that if all these properties are satisfied, then I know how to create a manifold. So the idea is what? Is that for each, so of course I've erased the thing, but so for each vertex that I had, so when the vertex was elementary, a cyclic group, then I will consider a solid torus. And what we know from the JSJ decomposition is that you have only finitely many edges attached to them. And so they will all be parallel inside the torus. And because the action is trivial here, I'm sure that it is, the action will be primitive. And primitive and simple because of the planarity. When I had the surface case, so the group is a free group with finitely many holes. We can multiply it by an interval to make it a three manifold. And each hole corresponds to edge groups also, and they are annuli from which I want to glue them together. In the rigid case, so this was the surface case. Yeah, so maybe here I should have added that there are z squared stabilized. Okay. In the rigid case, we have this pairing here, which is already given by the fact that we have the manifold. So we have. I don't know how to draw that. So we have a collection of annuli. Yeah, I guess I need at least two holes. And then we have the tori. So of course, I'm not used to making this talk, so parabolic, the tori vertices, okay, which I want to see as a something like that, an end. And similarly, I will have, because of my condition, a collection of curves on the boundary, which will all be parallel. And now I can use the graph T2 over G, which will tell me to which annulus I have to, how to pair the annuli together to build my manifold. And then it will have exactly the fundamental group I had started from, because it's, that's what the Bastiat theory is telling me. Right? And so in this case, the way I'm doing it, you can check that it will be irreducible at toroid down and all that. So I'm a little sketchy here. Essentially, this is over thanks to Thurston's uniformization theorem, if we have that. Okay? So in the word hyperbolic case, it's easy to see, well, easy. It follows from the work of Weiss and Hegel that the group has a special action on a K0 cube complex because it's word hyperbolic and we can employ all the theory. And in this case, we know that quasi-convex subgroups are separable, so we can clean up, get rid of all the elements that... everything which did not make it a regular JSJ decomposition. Okay, so then we'll be able to find a finite index subgroup. In the general case, it's not word hyperbolic, and I don't even know if I can find a torsion-free, if I can find an action on a K0 cube complex of the whole group. But what I know is that each piece is acting on a K0 cube complex, so not compactly, but co-sparsely, so meaning that it is geometrically finite in the realm of K0 cube complexes. And Weiss has a certain number of results concerning these issues, but of course, it's never exactly the right setting, so we had to adapt what he did. And so maybe one idea that actually he explained to me, because of course, we were kind of stuck. And I think it's interesting in its own right, and I will conclude with this. So how to use the fact that on each vertex, so you have a graph of groups. G is written as some sort of graph of groups inside have a collection of stuff like that. Okay, and what you know is you have very good properties on the vertices and on the edges. Right? And so what he told me to do was to say, well, what you just take quotients vertex by vertex and make sure that they match on the edges. If it's the case, then you'll get a first quotient to a hyperbolic group, or maybe even you can manage to make it virtually free. So we get some normal subgroup for each of those in such a way that when an edge is written VW, then the intersection of your normal subgroup corresponds exactly to the other one. Okay, and so for instance, if it has finite index, then each quotient will be finite, and we can create a graph of a new group, which will be the fundamental group of a graph of group with the same graph. But now what we gain is that
Maybe I should do it like that. GE over N of T. That this one will be virtually free. And using this kind of ideas, and to do that, it's not terribly hard because we know that we have a lot of freedom of these vertex groups because they act on cat zero Q complexes nicely. And so we can use what Wise did at this stage, okay, essentially. And then we make sure that everything matches, and once we're here, we can separate anything we want because it's a virtually free group. And then we can build a finite index subgroup where we'll get rid of everything. So of course, when we build this graph, we have to be careful not to put into the kernel the elements that we want to separate afterwards. Okay, so, but for this, we can use Dunn-Filling theorems and stuff like that. So it's a game between the monomial special quotient theorem and the standard Dunn-Filling theorems of Ossian, for instance, and make sure that everything goes exactly as we want in the end. And so here there is some work, but it essentially follows from what Wise did, but we still have to do some work to get it through. So I will stop here, and I thank you for your attention.